Meet Cain, Heather, and Rain. Together, they are the Collies of Heather Circle, and they share a life with my wife Donna and I that is filled with joy and love. And between them, they have brought comfort, cheer, and support to thousands of people from all walks of life. In the 18th century, the collie's natural home was in the highlands of Scotland, where it had been used for centuries as a sheepdog. The dogs were bred with great care in order to assist their masters in the herding and guarding of their flock. In 1879, the first collie was brought to the United States. Their popularity sparked with a series of books written in the early part of the 20th century by an American, Albert Payson Terhune, in which collies were featured as central characters. But it was the publication of the book Lassie Come Home in 1940 that popularity of the breed accelerated and came to be known as America's Dog. The book, written by Eric Knight, tells the story of a collie's trek over many miles to be reunited with the boy she loves. In 1946, the book was adapted into a movie, which became an immediate success and was followed by several sequels. And later, in 1954, it became an extremely popular television series, which lasted for 17 years.
Starring June Lockhart, Hugh Riley, John Provost as Timmy, and, of course, Lassie.
The impact the television series had during its run and the cultural influence it generated has endured to this day. Today, however, several factors have contributed to the loss of public esteem and recognition the breed once knew, and the American Kennel Club now lists the collie as ranking 37th in popularity. Those factors include the absence of the television show, a misconception that collies require extensive grooming, and the public trend toward adopting mixed-breed dogs from animal shelters rather than from breeders of purebred dogs. Although the rough coat sable color is the most recognizable collie, there are several other varieties, including the black, white, and brown tricolor, the sable merle, and the blue merle, and there is even a smooth-coated variety. Although Shetland sheepdogs, or Shelties, have been commonly mistaken for miniature collies, they are in fact a totally separate breed, and despite some similarities, they are not believed to have descended from collies. Because of their gentle temperament, collies are highly valued as family dogs. But they have proven themselves to be highly adaptable to a great many other activities. Heather, for example, excels in agility competitions. Rain learns techniques for herding sheep, while others compete in scent work, using their superior sense of smell in special competitions, and many have shown exceptional skill in obedience, as well as a wide variety of other competitions. Our friend Cynthia Casby's collies, including Potter, pictured here, has shown tremendous talent in a great variety of sports. Rain, Cain, and Heather also enjoy popularity on social media on their Facebook page, celebrating holidays and special events, and they've also had the opportunity to work as professional models in advertisements for such products as Ralph Lauren, Milkbone, and Gucci. But it is their work as therapy dogs with which they spend the majority of their time and in which we take our greatest pride. To best understand the purpose of therapy dogs and the work they perform, it is helpful to understand the differences between the three different types of service animals. A legitimate service dog is trained to perform a specific task for a disabled person. Guide dogs for the blind, dogs who assist people confined to wheelchairs, and those trained to alert their handlers of low blood sugar or to warn of an impending seizure, are the type of dogs who fall into this category. Remember that genuine service dogs must never be touched by anyone other than their handler while they are working, as it may distract them from performing a crucial task. Service dogs are authorized by the Americans with Disability Act, or ADA, to accompany their handlers into most public places such as restaurants and stores. It is important to note that they are the only dogs allowed this privilege. Unfortunately, many people have been placing vests labeled service dogs on their untrained, unauthorized pets in order to gain access to locations they might not otherwise be allowed. This inconsiderate, illegal practice has been increasing in recent years and is no different from an unauthorized vehicle parking in a spot marked for handicapped drivers only. New laws are presently being presented that will impose stiffer fines on individuals who infringe on this privilege. The second category is emotional support animal. Their primary function is to provide emotional support to their owner through companionship. A doctor's authorization is required in order for an animal to be designated in this category, but no training of any kind is required. The only special privileges emotional support animals enjoy is that they are allowed to live in residences where a no-pets policy is otherwise enforced. Most airlines will allow emotional support animals to travel in the cabin with their owners. However, in recent days, some airlines have amended this policy to require owners to declare that their pet is well-behaved and will not disrupt other passengers. Often, the owners of emotional support animals are under the mistaken impression that their dogs are actually service dogs and must be allowed access to public places under the ADA. This is not true. The third category is therapy dog. Their job is to provide emotional support and comfort to many people. A legitimate therapy dog is trained and certified by a dependable therapy dog organization and receives authorization before visiting individuals in such facilities as hospitals, nursing homes, and libraries. Like emotional support dogs, they are not allowed in public places such as restaurants and markets, and they are not covered by the Americans with Disability Act. Unlike service dogs, who must not be touched while working, a therapy dog's job is to be petted and touched, because it is through physical contact that they provide solace and relieve stress. There are several organizations which provide therapy dog training and certification. A list and contact information for those recognized by the American Kennel Club can be found at their website at akc.org. Although the requirements for certification varies by organization, there are certain qualifications that must be met in order to become a candidate. Dogs must be at least 1 year old and must know basic obedience such as sit and stay, and must be properly leash trained. These are all behaviors that are taught in any beginning obedience class. Before beginning therapy dog training, dogs must be thoroughly socialized with people of all ages and must be able to behave around other dogs. It is important to point out that temperament is of vital importance for any dog that may be considered for therapy dog work. Not every animal possesses the quiet, gentle nature required, and though temperament may be controlled with obedience, it cannot be trained. Sometimes, however, maturity may play an important part in a dog's behavior, and a young dog which may be considered too energetic may mellow with age, with some dogs not achieving maturity until they are 2 or 3 years old. Dogs who qualify for training very quickly learn that when they are wearing their leash and therapy dog vest, they are working and soon understand what is required of them. The characteristics of a dog's handler are every bit as important to a therapy dog team as a dog's temperament, and just as temperament is not something that can be taught to dogs, common sense is something that cannot be taught to people. Handlers must possess the personality and common sense to know how to properly interact with the people they visit, how to engage a patient, and to recognize how to approach them, particularly if an individual is fearful of dogs. Handlers must also have the ability to read their dogs, to understand if a dog is fearful or stressed, and know when to remove a dog if a situation requires. Our collies have been certified by a Southern California organization called Pet Prescription Team. This organization provides training, testing, certification, and ongoing monitoring and support, including insurance coverage, which protects handlers, dogs, and those they visit. And they assist in placing therapy dog teams with locations to visit. After a preliminary interview, Pet Prescription Team's program is comprised of 8 one-hour weekly sessions which consist of training both handlers and dogs, as well as extensively testing dogs for aptitude. such as how a dog will react around loud noises and distractions, and how well they will behave around an individual who may be fragile or infirm. They are taught such things as how to approach patients in wheelchairs and walkers, and they are taught the leave it command, which is given when food or items such as medicine or hypodermic needles have been dropped on the floor. Most of the classes are taught in a senior assisted care facility where trainees can interact with people, and the lessons there include encounters with seniors suffering from Alzheimer's and dementia. Dogs are familiarized with climbing stairs and riding in elevators, and taught how to circumnavigate obstacles they may encounter. Handlers are also taught that their dogs must be clean and well-groomed at all times, and must be bathed before visiting hospitals. At the conclusion of the 8-week session, dogs and handlers are tested on what they have learned and experienced, and they are required to pass an American Kennel Club Canine Good Citizen test, which assesses dog behavior and confirms that a dog is well-mannered and can be trusted to perform therapy dog duties. After successfully completing testing, dogs are issued vests identifying them as certified therapy dogs. These vests are required to be worn only while the dog is performing approved therapy dog duties, but must never be worn for any other purpose and may never be used to gain access to a public facility. After each assignment has been completed, handlers are required to complete a report detailing the visit and reporting any problems that may have been encountered. Members of our organization are very fortunate, as we are offered a wide variety of opportunities that most other therapy dog groups do not enjoy. This privilege is due to the fact that our leadership is dedicated to expanding the application of pet therapy. Like most organizations, our visits include visiting patients in hospitals, including children who are undergoing oncology treatments for cancer, and those in intensive care. Imagine a child who is undergoing treatment in an otherwise cold, sterile hospital, who is joined by a warm, friendly dog. Such an opportunity can completely change a child's perspective on the experience, and often helps take their mind off any pain or discomfort they may be experiencing. Studies have shown that interaction with a dog can lower blood pressure, help your body release a relaxation hormone, and cut down on levels of a stress hormone. Visits to senior care facilities and to those suffering from dementia and Alzheimer's brings the opportunity to cheer and comfort residents who are unable to care for a pet themselves. We also participate in several Orange County Library Read to the Dog programs, where children read aloud to our calm and patient dogs. Studies have shown that children who are often shy about reading aloud to adults will willingly read to a dog, because they know that a dog is non-judgmental. Often parents will bring their children who do not have a pet to these programs to allow them the opportunity just to be near a dog, even if they choose not to read. Other assignments include working with young people who suffer from brain injury. Each week we meet with them at a local soccer field where they are provided the opportunity to exercise and interact with our dogs. We also spend time with many other special needs children, often helping them overcome their fear of animals. Donna and I enjoy our monthly visits to a home which cares for foster children who require constant medical attention. The children are all under 6 years of age, and our visits provide them with the opportunity to interact with animals. Our colleagues spend time with students at both high school and colleges during finals week, helping relieve stress from study and testing. We have spent time at Ontario International Airport, visiting travels, waiting for outgoing flights, and helping relieve the anxiety they may be experiencing. And we spend time with families at Ronald McDonald House, where families reside while their children are confined in hospitals. Some of the therapy dogs from our organization comfort hospice patients, and Kane has been called upon by families to spend time with a loved one. Each year our group enjoys participating in the special games at Cal State Fullerton, where we greet hundreds of special needs children. With each visit, we often spend as much time interacting with staff members, helping them to get through a busy, demanding work schedule. The work our therapy dogs have performed is far-reaching and includes many different kinds of visits, too numerous to list here. Although all of our colleagues share the same tasks, Kane, who has been a therapy dog for 7 years, is often chosen by pet prescription team to be the first dog assigned to new and unique programs due to his reliability and experience. One such program takes place at the Children's Advocacy Center in Covina, a location to which young victims who have suffered sexual or physical abuse or who may have witnessed acts of violence are brought so that they may provide a forensic interview in order that authorities may bring charges against the perpetrators of these crimes. Kane sits with the children, and his presence aids them in feeling comfortable enough to relate their experience. As a result of this work, he has even been called upon to accompany a victim to court, where in one such instance last year he helped a young victim of abuse find the strength to testify against her molester, who, as a result, was convicted of his crime. In the coming months, Kane will be working other court assignments on a regular basis. In 2016, Kane was selected along with two other therapy dogs to serve the Los Angeles Sheriff's Department by comforting young victims of human trafficking. This association has resulted in other assignments, including the weekly visitation to inmates incarcerated at the Los Angeles Twin Towers Correctional Facility, which is the largest of its kind in the United States. Kane and Rain have convincingly calmed and altered the behavior of many troublesome inmates. As a part of this service, they have also worked with youths incarcerated at Los Angeles County Juvenile Halls. For several years, Kane has been called upon by OC Animal Care, which is the Orange County Animal Shelter, to participate in their Responsible Pet Ownership Program, teaching animal care to students in preschool through sixth grade. And Kane has been recognized by the Orange County Board of Supervisors for his participation, and was invited to help host the groundbreaking of the new animal shelter in Irvine. Kane has received several awards for his service, but perhaps the greatest honor was presented to him last year in Sacramento, California, where he was named by the Collie Club of America as their 2017 Shining Star Ambassador. This prestigious international award recognizes the Hero Collie of the Year from a large pool of applicants, and we are honored and humbled to receive this recognition. There is a very special bond between people and dogs, and we have found that the work we do with our dogs is as therapeutic for us as it is for those we visit. It has been said that dogs teach us to be human. Although you may not have the time to involve yourself as extensively with your dog as we have done, it's important to remember that if you choose to share your life with a pet, you have a responsibility to provide care, training, exercise, and playtime. None of us want to be ignored, and life can get pretty dull if you spend your whole day alone in the house or yard. Remember to take time for your dog. Good obedience training will help your dog to be easier to live with, but understand that proper training requires patience and consistency. Take your dog for a walk. Teach your dog tricks. Allow your dog to be a part of your life, because more than anything, that is what a dog wants. Your dog believes that you are his God, and given the opportunity, your dog will be your most steadfast, reliable friend and will love you unconditionally, because a dog is the only thing on earth that will love you more than you love yourself.